I am Jeff Foxworthy, and welcome to GameKeeper Podcast. If you want to learn more about farming for wildlife and habitat management, then buddy, you are in the right place. Join the GameKeeper crew direct from Mossy Oak Land Enhancement Studio as they discuss the latest wildlife and habitat management practices, news, and of course, hunting. There's no telling what you'll learn, but I'm going to tell you, I bet it's interesting. Enjoy.
We're live in 3, 2, 1.
Here we go, guys. Dudley, thank you for finally coming on in here.
Yeah. Good. I needed a couple more sips of coffee.
Yeah.
Did you have your eggs and everything?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, good. Good.
Here we are.
No doubt about it, turkey season has ended here, because I am busy as I can be. I'm going to tell you what.
I was ready for it to be done, really.
Mm. Well,
I don't know if I was ready, but, you know, it's always good to close the chapter and start, you know, working on stuff or putting the shade house up at the nursery. So I've been getting, it's actually a little sunshine this week, so lots of activity over there.
I still got a chapter going. I'm not closing my book just yet.
Oh, yeah, you're going to travel, aren't you?
Well, just for a few days.
We'll keep holding it down for you while you turkey hunt across
the country.
Please,
I've been here the whole spring.
I will say I'm a little jealous of these people that somehow can just turkey hunt for 3 months straight across the country. But yeah. I don't know how they pull that off.
Yeah, those guys and those guys that follow these concerts everywhere and just go.
I'm just jealous of you, Dudley. Yeah, you get here at 9:30. Yeah. What is that? That makes me.
Yeah, it makes me jealous too.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does. Hey, but let me tell you something, Bobby.
Go ahead.
I'm working on the nursery over there. You let us borrow, you know, this I'm going to call it your LS tractor.
Well, it's our LS tractor.
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, they brought this unbelievable fleet of equipment and there was this little bitty one. You know, and I was like, Bobby was like, this is perfect for Bobby. And you bragged on it. But let me tell you what, I spent some hours on that thing. That is the handiest little, and it's not really that little, but it's one very useful piece of equipment.
And it runs like a top.
Like a top.
Well, it seems like in recent times, tractor companies, including LS, are making these smaller tractors that are more powerful.
Yeah.
And heavier, even though they're smaller, so they can do a lot more work in a smaller package. And the beauty of it is you can put them on a trailer. You just need a little gas burner truck. You don't have to own a big diesel anymore. Yeah. And you can get a lot of work done with a smaller package.
You really can.
And that one's four-wheel drive. I think that helps as well.
Oh, yeah. No, it's handy as it can be. So I'm going to keep on barring it. I'm going to get back to you eventually.
Yeah.
Did you use a little belly mower on it?
Used a little belly. You know, before I left the nursery, Dave, of course, was like, hey, can you use the mower while you're here? And I'm like, oh, okay. But no, we've been using the backhoe attachment in the bucket. And just it's just handy as it could be. So, anyways,
it is.
So can I put my name in the hat?
You can.
I don't know, Rich.
I think it's going to my house. Then Dave, I've got to drop it off in Prairie, and then I think we can get to Caledonia with it eventually.
Look, I'm gonna say, Rich, the new soundboard needs to be hooked up that we purchased 6 months ago.
Hey, we got all systems going right now.
Everything's working.
It's working right now. So
wait, let's not jinx ourselves.
Just keep our fingers crossed. And
yeah, but Richie, LS, your house.
Well, look, okay, let's keep this thing moving. We got guests on the phone, but I wanted to hit on blood on the biologic, which is brought to you by LS. You guys got anybody you want to bring up? Because I got a good one.
Do you have a good one? The only thing, one I can remember is my good buddy, old Mac Thatcher over there. You know, he came in, and I have to tell you, a guy told me, actually Ken Ivey said this, you know, when one of your buddies kills a turkey, you know, you're 98% jealous and 2% happy for him. So we're very happy for Mac Thatcher right there, buddy.
Yeah, so you're in that 98 to 2%.
No, I'm 2% happy.
Yeah, okay, well, I heard you slam his door the other day. Yeah, so.
Just a little jealous.
Well, congratulations, Mac.
So did anybody in this room tag out?
That is, I have quit putting that as a success for my season.
Yeah.
Probably four or five years ago.
Nobody tries anymore.
That's all I was worried about.
I can't remember the last time I tagged out.
When's the last time you tagged?
Last year, Bobby.
Last year, okay.
but I knew I was going to get that. My point is that we all love turkey hunting, but there's a lot of other fun stuff you can do out there. And,
I think it's not really
all about tagging out.
No, just enjoy the hunt. You know, that's what it's about.
You don't have to kill one to enjoy.
No, yeah. And we were lucky we got to hunt a lot when we were younger too. So a lot of us are in, you know, with our kids and spending time with family. And I'd really, you know, that's just where it's at. So.
And Dudley's living proof. You don't have to kill one to have a good time.
That's right. That's
exactly he's living right. proof. So I wanted to call out Ava Paradise, 13 years old.
I hadn't heard about this.
With her back against a tree. Kills a the picture is just gorgeous. The turkey's huge.
They got some big old turkeys in Ohio. They really do.
Chris Paradise's daughter up there. It was a fantastic picture. So congrats.
That's awesome. Congrats. Love to hear that.
I saw where my young buddy Ryder Russell got one up in Missouri. His dad is Ryan Russell.
Oh yeah,
who was our oak nerd.
Yeah.
He knows more about oaks than I do.
That's saying a lot.
He helps us collect seed. He's like found all these state record trees, and Ryder is good at the outdoors as well. He's got a little page called Missouri Arrowheads.
Ah.
Y'all ought to check it out.
Is it on the ground?
He finds some heaters and stuff.
Yeah, that's cool.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, and speaking of 98% happy, 2% I mean, 98% jealous, 2% happy, your buddy Riley Payne got on the board one more time, too.
He sure did.
He sure did. Look at how much he's grinning over there. Is that green? That's the green grin.
No, you know, blind hog finds an acorn every once in a while is what they say.
So, wait, where are you going?
It's an undisclosed location.
Okay.
So, let me just say this. Hercules, the land of Hercules.
Oh, okay. We know where we're going. Somebody's the only one that gets an invite up there.
Yeah, well, you know. So, look, let's move this thing along. I sense that it's going in a bad direction. Today, we're going to talk about ticks.
And?
Lyme disease.
And? White-tailed deer.
Yes. Things that we all... Look, yeah. I really worry about ticks. I go to a lot of effort.
Think about it all the time now. I think about ticks more than I do snakes.
I'm more afraid of ticks than snakes. Yeah. That's for sure.
And teaching my kids how to use the mirror to check different places and, you know, be sure they don't have them on.
Oh yeah. Well,
in fact, after our buddy Blake Hamilton almost died 5 or 6 years ago.
Hell yeah.
It took me a while to feel comfortable being out in the woods. Well, I'm not going to lie.
Well, you're hearing not only about Lyme disease, you're hearing about alpha gal and these, you know, and when we talked to Dr. Demarius about the life cycle of a tick,
Yeah.
So if that doesn't get you.
Let's go ahead and introduce our guests and get this thing started. So we've got Dr. Stephen Rich. And he's a professor of microbiology, and he's also the executive director of the New England Center of Excellence in Vector-Borne Diseases.
Vector.
These guys are really smart. So, Dr. Rich, we appreciate having you on.
Yeah.
Pleasure to be here.
Yeah. And then I think, guys, and I'm just going to go ahead and try to introduce him, but I think Dr. Lyon Brown is – Lyon, are you there?
I'm here.
All right.
There he is. Lyon, is it true you missed a turkey this spring?
Yeah, it's a pretty embarrassing story. We'll spare the listeners. I'm here on the pod, not for my turkey skills. So,
Dr. Rich, what we're hoping to do with Dr. Brown is we may not understand some of the things you're talking about, and he's kind of a local guy, a medical doctor, and we were just trying to kind of help understand and maybe ask the best questions that we could. So that's what our intentions are. But
so yeah, we were listening to the radio. Back to the subject. Sorry for butting in there, Bobby. But I think we were listening to the radio and heard about this study that we're going to talk about today.
Yeah. So Dr. Rich, could you kind of tell us about the latest information that you seem to have been able to some research that you've done?
Yeah. So we've known for quite some time now that it's a little unusual, but ticks need deer to reproduce. In fact, that's where they reproduce, on the backs of deer. But what's curious about it is that the deer don't maintain the bacterium, the germ that causes Lyme disease. And in fact, there's something about deer, and we've known this for a while, there's something about deer that kills the Lyme disease bacterium. And that's been a bit of a puzzle for us for a while. And the experiment you're thinking about that was recently published, we went in and we found that it is actually something in the blood of the deer. We don't know precisely what it is yet, but there's something in the deer, white-tailed deer blood, that kills the agent of Lyme disease, or the bacterium that causes Lyme disease. And so people are pretty excited about that, as are we.
Gosh, when I just hearing that, it like gives you hope that there's some kind of maybe on the horizon there's some really good news. We know several people that have had Lyme disease.
A multitude of that. And I guess vector-borne, would that be – how is that tick-borne?
Tick-borne, yeah.
Lots of illnesses.
We've had you've had a dog that was on the – just
– on his deathbed.
And they finally determined that it was a tick. Mm-hmm. Something with a tick was going on. So, boy, ticks are just a major issue. And does it seem like there's more ticks? Doctor, I'm looking at you. You're here on Zoom. But can you talk a little bit about ticks and how we can help protect ourselves a little bit?
Yeah, so we say there are more ticks in more places. That's what we all know. So those of us that are of a certain age remember a time where parts of the country there weren't ticks in the past, and now they seem to be virtually everywhere. So the best things you can do are personal protections. So you can get DEET, for example, and spray that on your skin. The product we're really like very much, there's a bunch of different brand names of it, but the active ingredient is called permethrin. Mm-hmm. You can buy cans of permethrin. I always tell people wherever you can buy ammunition, you can buy permethrin, hardware stores, et cetera. And you just spray your clothing with this. It's called an acaricide, which just means it's a pesticide that kills ticks. And it will provide protection for sometimes up to 30 washes of that clothing. So you put it on your socks, you put it on your boots, you put it on your pants. And what happens is the ticks get on, and when their feet touch that fabric, they're poisoned and they die.
I like the way that sounds.
Well, I know Dudley's been a big advocate of it for a long time.
Yeah, there's so many ways you can get it. I usually buy like a quart of it in a 10% solution. And I believe you mix it down to a 0.5% solution, if I'm not mistaken, and treat my clothing with it.
There's a whole bunch of different products. So if you go in an average feed store, you'll see just walls and walls of products of permethrin. Some of them are formulated to go on horses and livestock. There are some that are specifically engineered to go onto fabrics, and I'd encourage you to find the ones that go onto that. Usually you don't have to dilute it at all. It comes in either an aerosol can or a pump spray, and the directions are right on the back of the bottle on how to put them on.
There you go.
Hey, Lyon, if you're still there, could you talk to us just a little bit about Lyme disease and if there may be some listeners that don't know just how bad that is?
Yeah, I'll be happy to. Kind of to touch on what they mentioned earlier, you know, how we're seeing ticks more and more everywhere. Lyme disease specifically, you know, as you learn about it, as far as mostly classically, endemically, it's not really going to be in our area, you know, just kind of, you know, particularly him being from New Jersey, New England states, that's where you're really going to see Lyme disease preferably, mostly there in the Midwest, but it's spreading. And over the last 5 years, you're seeing more and more Lyme disease cases in areas where you wouldn't expect to see it. You know, there's all kinds of ticks. We really deal with, you know, the ticks down here is going to cause a little bit different type of tick-borne disease than Lyme disease, but Lyme disease, of course, is the most common. It's the most serious as far as it can cause the longest, you know, manifestations, and you can deal with, you know, diseases and, you know, manifestations of disease for longest in Lyme disease. Really, when you think of Lyme disease, you're going to get symptoms in really three separate phases. A lot of the times you're going to see the people that see a tick, they go hunting, maybe 2 or 3 days later, you feel like you notice you have a tick. And then those people, and if you can remove it within 72 hours, most of the time, you're not going to really deal with any symptoms. If you do have any symptoms at all, it's going to be, you know, muscle aches and fevers. If you'll see the classic bullseye rash they always talk about, it's called erythema migrans. Most cases start and end with that. And it was pretty mild, situations, you know, once you see those things, once you have the history of having a tick and you start noticing fevers and maybe the rash, you can take an oral antibiotic and it usually knocks it out pretty good. But when Lyme disease gets serious is when it's really, you start having symptoms longer than 4 weeks, or maybe that you didn't notice the tick's been there for, you know, a week or two even, then you're going to start seeing more concerning symptoms that starts affecting your nervous system, your heart. It can start causing arrhythmias and make your heart slow down to where it could cause, you know, stroke and heart attack. You could develop meningitis and symptoms that look like you're having a stroke as well. And that's the main worry when it comes to Lyme disease. Luckily, most cases don't get there. And even if you do get to that point, you know, you can transition to IV antibiotics and, you know, take them most times up to 4 weeks. And it's got a pretty good cure rate for that. But that's why Lyme disease is so prevalent, is because it is the most common and it could possibly be the most dangerous as well. Mm.
Is it a bacteria or a virus or what is it?
Bacteria Borrelia burgdorferi is kind of what is being transmitted from the tick. And then once it's in your bloodstream, then you treat it like it's antibacterial, like with antibiotics. So yeah, to answer your question simply, it's a bacteria that's transmitted from the tick.
Wow. So Dr. Rich, when you're up there at kind of ground zero for Lyme disease in New England, where you're in Massachusetts, how long have you guys been, has this been on your radar and have y'all been studying it?
I've been studying this since 1992 when I was a graduate student and continued those studies throughout. So in 1992, which is 15 years or so after the first reported case. So the disease takes its name from Lyme, Connecticut, where it was first identified in a group of kids. And at that, you know, for 15 years or so after that, it was mostly restricted to coastal New England. So areas of Connecticut, Massachusetts, Rhode Island sort of hugged the coast very close. There was another focus in the upper Midwest and in Northwest Wisconsin, but not widespread like we're seeing today. And in the 30 plus years that I've been working on it, we've just seen it spread inward, southward, northward, basically in every direction. There are more ticks in more places, and everywhere they go, they carry this bacterium that Dr. Brown was referring to that gets into you and then causes diseases in you. And I'd also emphasize that it's not just that one bacterium. There is the one bacterium that causes Lyme disease, but not to scare people, but there's a whole host of different bacteria and viruses that are transmitted by the same ticks. So we sometimes refer to it as a constellation of threats that come out of this individual tick. Mm.
And that is that the Lyme disease is this Borrelia genus of bacteria. Is that only carried by one species of tick?
Yes, it's carried almost exclusively by the black-legged tick, which is also called the deer tick. There's a Western version of it in California, California, Washington, and Oregon. But here, east of the Mississippi, it's one tick called the black-legged tick. There are three species of ticks that bite people, primarily the dog tick, the black-legged tick, and the Lone Star tick. But only one of those three is associated with transmission of Lyme disease.
Wow. So do you think that Lyme disease has been around for a long time, or is it a relatively new thing?
It's been around for a very, very long time. And we know that because we can look at the DNA and we can see that it has a very ancient association with ticks. It's a very good question, though, because there's a group from, I think they may have originated from New York, that were proposing that maybe this was something that was developed in a military laboratory as a weapon and then released. And there's really no evidence that that's the case. This is pretty clearly something that's been around for a very long time, predates European settlements in North America. And in fact, it's spread throughout the Northern Hemisphere. So all the way across Europe and Asia and North America, we see prevalence of these ticks transmitting these diseases.
So interesting. Do you think it is it more prevalent now, or have we just not been good at diagnosing and keeping records? Were people dying of just something mysterious that was never diagnosed or attributed to something else?
Yeah, you're asking all the great questions. So the answer to both of those is yes. There's more of it than there ever has been. And what's going on is there are more white-tailed deer than there ever have been historically. More white-tailed deer means more ticks. More ticks means more Lyme disease. So there's much more of it than there was. And there's much more being reported than there ever was. And still, with around 40,000 cases reported annually every year, which exceeds the number of, for example, new HIV cases in the world or in the country. But with about 40,000 cases, we realize that that's probably one in 10 actual cases. So 40,000 cases get reported, but probably closer to 400,000 people are suffering from these infections.
Wow.
Great questions, Dudley. Great questions.
Okay, I've got one more. You know, you were mentioning that there is something to do with the white-tailed deer or deer in general, where I guess they don't get Lyme disease or they're able to fend it off. Is there like a demographic of humans? You know, Native Americans were here a long time ago and they were around white-tailed deer. Are they more apt less apt to getting Lyme disease? Has anybody ever done a study on that?
No, there's no evidence of ethnic differences in susceptibility to Lyme disease. And in fact, there's lots of other species that have been around for a long time. Well, the white-footed mouse, which is very important to the maintenance of that transmission cycle, they've been around for a long time too, and they don't have resistance to this. In fact, they're the primary source of infection for other ticks. So deer, something special about deer blood, we think it's something called a complement factor, part of the deer's immune system. And it's somehow resolved or evolved a resistance to this mechanism that shuts down the immune system and every other species that the ticks bite.
Wow. So do you think that mule deer would be resistant as well, and elk?
Mule deer, sika deer, lots of different cervids. We don't know about moose. And offhand, I don't know about elk, but yeah, most of the cervid species have this phenomenon.
Dr. Rich, I have a question for you, if that's all right, Bobby.
Yeah,
of course.
Yeah, I mean, I was reading through your paper and congrats on your research. It's very cool what y'all have done, and to be the first ones, it says a lot. I guess my question kind of on the medical doctor side of things, I imagine the next step is trying to figure out what mechanisms exactly is involved with kind of why this is working. And I mean, I know it's early, and how confident are you in thinking that this is some sort of way to be able to translate it to treating humans and maybe at least inducing some sort of prophylaxis or whatever, how the way you think we could use it?
Yeah. So before I answer that question, I want to ask a question that you didn't ask, but maybe some of your listeners will be thinking, like, does it help to drink deer blood, or can I rub deer blood on my body or something like that? Those things are what we're proposing are going to be.
Ivermectin.
Yeah.
We didn't want to make you think hope we didn't misrepresent that we have a lot of listeners here. But guaranteed some of them would think about drinking deer blood.
Well, they're not going to get any benefit of protection from Lyme disease. But yeah, the answer to the question is our hope is that we can pin down precisely what that factor is in the deer. And again, we're not going to propose to turn people into having deer blood factors. But we are hoping if we can identify the specific mechanism, then we can identify some pharmacological agents that can mimic that performance of what the deer are doing. So if we can make our immune system do what deer's immune system is doing by some enhanced chemistry, then that's the hope that we have.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah.
Hey, super white tail.
Yeah. My non-medical mind was thinking something similar, just like, you know, you get insulin maybe from something or whatever, but you're isolating like a gene or something that you could give to a human and cause them to not be infected.
Yeah.
You got it.
Yeah, okay. I guess to build off of that, if I may, Bobby, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I mentioned most Lyme disease doesn't get to the point to where it's too harmful. I guess the next, even if you figure out how to do it, would be what kind of patient population, you know, we're using it prophylactic in endemic areas. Is it become a treatment for someone who's maybe had symptoms for a prolonged amount of time? Because I was kind of thinking, I haven't done the research like you, but the subset of patients for the listeners as well, they don't know. A lot of people suffer for what they even have a diagnosis for now called post-Lyme disease syndrome, to where there's really no explanation that's been figured out. Basically, someone has had Lyme disease in the previous 6 months, 9 months, 2 years even, that still wake up every day with aches and pains and fatigue and kind of almost some weird neurological type stuff, some confusion. And there's no other reason to, you know, there's no etiology to it other than that they've figured out maybe there's some prolonged, you know, something going on with the DNA or whatever that's causing these symptoms. And you don't do anything for it. You know, there's no role for antibiotics then, which is how you treat Lyme disease. So just kind of me brainstorming, I was wondering if maybe if we get to the point where we get using this in humans, I wonder if that could be something that would maybe could benefit those patients.
Yeah. Always the hope is that you get more tools in the toolbox, right? So it's going to be a multi-pronged approach. There are some horrible cases about people that have these long-term consequences, long-term symptoms. The hope is that we would have just one more thing that if this doesn't work, you got another tool that you can try. That's the best we can hope for.
So, Dr. Rich, I'm sitting here itching just listening to talk about
the same thing. I got a tick crawling up my back.
I'm just wondering, are you around ticks all day long in a lab somewhere? Does one ever slide home with you and you're sitting there eating supper and all of a sudden he crawl out on your neck or something?
So I am a college professor, so I teach students. So I was in class the other day, and I wasn't talking about Lyme disease, but I was talking about disease. And I walked into the room, and I set up my computer, and I was about to talk, and I put my hand on the back of my leg just to scratch something, and I felt something there. And sure enough, there was a tick on my leg underneath my pants. And so I described what is probably also useful public information is there's two ways you can find ticks. One is with your eyes. Someone mentioned that. But the other is you've got these things. You've got your fingers. And someone had mentioned that they have their kids looking at different parts of their body with a mirror, which is also good.
I don't think we say kid.
No, I was teaching my kids. I mean, you know, you got to check places.
Okay. I just don't want to get a lot of emails about that.
Check themselves.
You can feel them.
Yeah, you can really feel them. I can feel them when they bite me.
It either feels like a bead of sweat going down my leg or a tick, there's very little difference in that feeling. No. So I always check that.
Yeah. So did you get up and run out of class? So did you get up and run out of class?
No, I took one for the team. I carried on the class, and then I shot out of there and went home. And
you're a warrior. Yeah.
Any of y'all, like, back when you were dating in high school, ever, you know, kissing on your girlfriend and run your hand through her hair and find a tick?
I'm sure you did.
Actually.
Of course.
There was a guy in my forestry class, and his nickname was Tick because.
You have a gray tick on
He him? Was, you know, having a kissing on his girlfriend, and he felt a tick on her back and pulled it off.
There you go. Good for him.
Tick, if you're listening.
Yeah.
Did he slip it off secretly or did he tell
it's been so long.
I tell you what, I mean, I'm going to go and tell you, you know, your wife plays a good role in looking at ticks on you. I mean, you know, so you got to get them ready for that.
Okay.
Well, I don't know where to go from here. What about like the different life stages of ticks? Can they all carry or can they all transmit it? Or does it have to be the older stages?
So there are three stages. There's a larva, a nymph, sort of a baby, a teenager, and then an adult tick. So the babiest of the ticks, the larval ticks, they're born without infection. So they have to acquire infection by feeding on a mouse. So if you're lucky enough to be fed on by one of those ticks, that's about the cleanest tick you can get because it has not fed on anything else to pick up that infection. They say the most dangerous tick is the nymphal tick. So that's the one in the middle. And it's not more dangerous because it has a higher likelihood of infection. It has about a 25% chance that that tick has the bacterium in it, but it's more dangerous because it's smaller and it's more likely to feed long enough on your body so that you get the bacterium. The adult ticks can also transmit, although the adult males don't feed, only the adult females feed.
What are the layman's terms for those stages? We always call them seed ticks. Yeah. Is that where you were going, Lenny?
That is where I was going. You read my mind, Dudley.
You know, I don't always know what people mean by seed tick. I think they sometimes just think of ticks as some ticks are smaller than others, like dog ticks are larger than black-legged ticks. So I'm not sure what people always mean when they see seed tick, but the scientific basis, we call them larvae, nymphs, and adults.
Okay, so does the larvae look like a very, very small tick, or is it looks like a little worm or something.
Yeah. Well, so that nymphotic, the middle one, it's about the size of a poppy seed that you'd have on a, poppy seed on a baked item or something. And larval ticks are smaller than that. And you wouldn't be able to see this without a lens or a magnifying glass, but they only have 6 legs. That's the way we distinguish the larvae from the others. Ticks are not insects. They're actually more closely related to spiders. And so in the adult forms and in the teenage forms, they always have 8 legs. But that little tiny larval species has, or stage has 6 legs.
Okay. So I would assume that we refer to seed ticks as both the two earliest stages.
I would think so. And typically with seed ticks with us, it's not like there's one of them. You're going across a field or going through some brush and you look down and there's literally hundreds of them, that you can barely see coming up you.
What is the family name that the ticks are in?
So ticks, the black-legged ticks are in the genus Ixodes.
Okay.
And the tick that you're talking about that you see in those big bunches, that's probably in the genus Amblyomma. The common name for that one is the Lone Star tick. It's also known as the turkey tick. You guys were talking about turkey hunting before, because they did seem to favor turkeys in the past. And you see these in great numbers. And the difference between them, a fundamental difference between the black-legged tick and the Lone Star tick, the black-legged tick is a very passive tick, actually. It climbs up to the top of a branch. It waits for you or a deer or your dog to walk by, and then it grabs on. Lone Star ticks, they're more aggressive. They'll walk across your picnic blanket to get on you, and they're much more aggressive feeders, and they'll come in these big groups like you were describing.
I believe we have a lot of those in the Southeast. Mm-hmm. Is that the one that has the white dot on its back?
That's why they're called a Lone Star tick. Some people think it's...
Looks like the state of Texas.
Yeah. Hmm. This making you itchy now, Bobby?
I'm scratching everywhere.
It is. I'm thinking very hard about them. Lord have mercy. So my question, and I think you may have answered this, Dr. Rich, but why are there so many more ticks now than there used to be? Is there anything you can put your finger on?
Yeah, it's the white-tailed deer. So the black-legged tick in particular won't breed virtually any other place except on the back of a white-tailed deer. So as juveniles, they feed on chipmunks, white-footed mice, squirrels, et cetera. But as adults, they only feed and they only start their families on the back of a white-tailed deer. And the preponderance, the density of white-tails are just so much higher now. Just to throw some numbers at you, one female fed tick can lay 2,000 to 3,000 eggs, and one white-tailed deer can feed several thousand black-legged ticks. So you got one deer, thousands of ticks, 3,000 eggs. You got an instant problem when they're introduced that way.
But the small ticks or the new ticks aren't infected. So they've got to leave that deer. And the reason I'm kind of getting around to another observation I've had over the past few years around here with specifically with field equipment, leaving equipment in the fields. I think we've got a rodent problem too. I think there's an increased amount of those in areas. Is that where they get the actual bacteria from? So,
Yeah, most really from the white-footed mice. In fact, remember that was the study we did. If the tick feeds on a deer, it won't get infected. This is the weird thing about this cycle. If there were only white-tailed deer and no mice, we wouldn't have a Lyme disease problem. We'd have tons of ticks because they breed so well on the white-tailed deer. But if we didn't have mice, it wouldn't introduce the infection.
So I don't know what anybody else's field observation are. And it's directly related to, again, leaving equipment in fields and they're eating the wiring off of it. Mm. It's just been...
My truck.
Your truck got them in it.
I don't know if white-footed mice inhabit tractors and truck engines, though.
I don't know.
They do.
They do. Okay.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering if like the habitat has changed over the years. There's not as many frequent fires in the far. Mm-hmm. Maybe the habitat has changed to allow the white-footed mouse to proliferate more than it has, or maybe one of its predators is fewer in number.
I don't know. We got more deer, obviously, and it seems like we have more mice.
It's more about the deer. I think the white-footed mice, they're always pretty abundant and they adapt pretty well. They live paradomestically. So if you get if you see a mouse in your kitchen, it's probably a white-footed mouse, not a house mouse. They'll live virtually anywhere. What's really changed is the way we manage landscapes that facilitates the proliferation of the white-tailed deer. So here in New England, everybody loves nice stone walls and manicured lawns with nice edge habitat on the forest. That's perfect habitat for deer. Mm-hmm. And they're more abundant than they ever been. And less hunter, frankly.
Yeah, no, that's good. That's what we're working on down here.
Well, it's very encouraging that you guys have isolated this or realized it. And I mean, I guess this is how cures
about. And, we're so amazed by the whitetail, and there's just another gold star by the old whitetail for us.
So, Doc, there's probably some questions that you said, well, if these guys have any sense about them, they'll ask me this or that. But is there something that we haven't asked that's a part of this story?
Well, you started to touch on something when you were talking about the tick, feeling the tick like a bead of sweat. There's a great thing to think about there is that ticks not only transmit pathogens or germs or bacteria, they also induce allergies. So what you're probably experiencing, I have this a bit myself, when you feel a tick on you, you probably are somewhat sensitized. So that's your sort of an allergic reaction in a favorable sense that your body is telling you, I've got a tick on me, and you feel it and pluck it off. But on the downside of that, there are allergies that can be associated with tick bites that can really be debilitating, things like the alpha gal allergy or the red meat allergy. And still a lot to be understood about that. It's primarily associated with the Lone Star tick, not the black-legged tick. But what happens is you get bit by a tick. The tick introduces what looks like a sugar that's present in red meat. And it induces an immune response in you so that the next time you eat red meat, you have allergy to that red meat. And it's for some people, it's quite debilitating, like not just like a stomach discomfort, but people actually go into anaphylactic shock and have really strong responses, not to the tick, but to the red meat that they eat after they've been exposed by the tick.
So, Doc, I want to, you can't see him, but Mac Thatcher's here with us. He's our fact checker, but Mac's mother has this alpha gal. So, Mac, I'm sure you've got a comment.
I do. And the random thing about my mom having that allergic disease is there's about six or seven other people within our neighborhood or their neighborhood that I grew up in that also has it. And I was curious if that disease is, hosted in, ticks in a certain area more prevalently. And then what percentage of ticks carry that disease, as well as what percentage of ticks carry the Lyme disease?
Yeah, I wish I had a good answer for you. But since we don't even know precisely what it is, whether it's something that the tick picks up when it feeds on the blood, or whether it's something that the tick is producing itself, we don't know precisely what it is. And we don't know absolutely that it's only associated with one tick species. But the best indication is that wherever there's Lone Star ticks, that's throughout the Southeast and now upwards into the Northeast and upper Midwest, wherever those Lone Stars are, people have a susceptibility to this. It's not clear why not every tick bite ends up in the situation like your mom's unfortunately ended up in. It could be that there's something about your mom's makeup, like maybe she has a genetic susceptibility to that. Could be something that's different about the tick that fed on her. We don't know. We need a lot more research in that area to pin down exactly what's going on. But a lot of people are suffering from it, and it's a growing problem.
To kind of touch on what he was saying about the Lone Star tick being the most prevalent one that's going to be, transmitting the alpha gal that we see. And like I was mentioning earlier, here in Mississippi where we live and Alabama, there's local areas that we associate with people. I think that's why, I mean, growing up before I was even, med school, you always hear a lot more about alpha gal than you do Lyme disease. And that's probably because that we're dealing more with Lone Star tick down here and not with the deer tick, that's going to be the one passing the Lyme disease. So I always thought that was pretty interesting, even though we know so much less about alpha gal. That's why I feel like it's more prevalent here. We hear about it more because of the tick.
So, Dr. Rich, just anecdotally, I had a guy that I was visiting with, Lanny, I think I shared this with you, that son had alpha gal. He's from Amory, and he had it really bad. And this man just dedicated his, he just kind of shut himself down for a few months and started to tried to determine what his son could eat. And he found out, they went to MD Anderson, and he found out that he had alpha gal for sure, but he could eat venison if he made sure there was no fat in it. They cut out all that silver meat or whatever. Mm-hmm. And he said, we just processed our own venison just as carefully as we could, and he could eat that without any problems. But he couldn't have he determined that it was fat was the problem causing the problem for his alpha gal. Now, that may have just been him, and I don't want to be spreading anything, but I'm looking at these two doctors and just say, have they heard anything like that?
Not me. No, I haven't heard any. That's a really interesting case, especially the fact that he was able, they even broke it down to the, whether it was meat versus fat, but no, I haven't heard anything like that. I'm not sure there's much out there about what parts of meat may be more, tolerated with patients with alpha gal. Dr. Rich may have.
So yeah, we work with allergists. Scott Commons is one of the people that first identified this phenomenon. And one thing we know about allergies and the immune system is how little we know about them. Mm-hmm. You can become allergic to almost anything. Sounds to me like that individual might have had an allergy to something other than alpha gal. It amounted to the same thing. But I haven't heard of anything where an alpha gal was specific such that it didn't have a reaction with deer meat. But yeah, our immune systems, allergies in particular, are a really weird beast.
Yeah. Lanny, you look like you had a comment.
Yeah, Dudley and I have talked about this a lot. It seems like some people are getting some relief from alpha gal through homeopathic treatments like acupuncture. And I guess that speaks to the complexity of the immune system, what's going on with that. Have you heard anything about that?
Yeah, there's all kinds of things that people try to reduce the effects. And in some cases, they're self-limiting, meaning that in time, the symptoms seem to subside. And again, why that is, we don't know. Why some people's persist longer than others is an open question. But some people have it so bad that it's not even just what they eat. They even report that products that have, shampoos or cosmetics that have animal byproducts in them as a consequence of their manufacture, that people have reactions to those. So not only are you allergic to a cheeseburger, but you can't use a certain shampoo.
I could do without the shampoo, but the cheeseburger is pretty essential.
Look, Dr. Rich and I will attest shampoo is overrated.
Yeah, that's what's so interesting about this is, I was looking at all of your pubs, and like you said, they go back to like 92, and there's other folks that have been working on this almost exclusively, and there's still just so many unknowns out there. It's almost like an alien disease that we can't quite get a hold of. I guess we need more folks going into this field and trying to learn more. It's fascinating and scary at the same time.
Mac, you got a question?
I do. Lyon, I got a question for you. So a lot of times when people probably listen to this podcast or getting bit by ticks is either, in their garden or during turkey season, but you're also tired. You've been walking around a bunch and you're getting bit by ticks. So what are some factors to look for that you might want to go get checked out for Lyme disease? Cause I'm pretty tired and achy during turkey season and get bit by ticks, but I don't think I have Lyme disease. So like, what would be some things that you would suggest people to look out for as symptoms?
Well, the thing we encourage people to do is to keep that tick, because the tick sort of serves as a record of what exposures you might have had. Some ticks transmit Lyme disease, others don't. Some seem to be associated with alpha gal, others aren't. And there's actually 21 or 22 different things that have that arrangement, that some ticks transmit some things. So the best information you can have about a tick that bit you is that tick. And so Dr. Brown alluded to the fact that you get bitten and then some weeks later you can get a test. It's important to remember that if I get bit by a tick today, it's going to take a few weeks before my body generates the immune response, which is the thing that's going to be used in the testing to determine if I have Lyme disease. However, the tick that I just took off myself, that can be tested today. and there's services across the country where you can test, send that tick, and they can tell you this is a tick that's associated with alpha gal, or this is a tick associated with Powassan virus, or whatever else is out there. And so that information is very, very valuable, because when you get to the point where it's the end of the turkey season, you knew you got bit by three ticks, and you've got these aches in your knees that maybe it's just because you're getting older now, but maybe it's because of something associated with that tick, you can go back to that tick sort of as an archive and have it tested, and they can determine whether you had an exposure that your doc would want to know about.
Yeah, I mean, to touch on that, I mean, we're pretty confident through studies that if that tick's been on you for less than 36 hours, you almost have 0% chance of developing Lyme disease. So if you basically, you're in the shower that day, you know that you don't have a tick, you go turkey on that morning, that afternoon, the next morning, you see that you have a tick and you pull it off, you can be pretty confident you're not going to develop Lyme disease or really even any symptoms. And if you do have that tick and it's been there a while, and just like Dr. Rich says, you don't know what tick it is, you lose the tick. If you go see a doctor based on, even if they know the tick's was on you, you can be pretty confident it's been there for 3 or 4 days. You can even get a single dose antibiotic, kind of like a prophylactic dose that should take care of most symptoms. And even if you don't do all that, at least 80 to 85% of people with Lyme disease is going to develop that bullseye rash. And that's going to develop within 2 to 4 weeks, even if you're having these non-specific symptoms, like you're saying, Mac, fatigue and aches and pains. But if you don't see that rash and you're still worried, you're a worrier and it's been 4 weeks and you still haven't seen that rash, you also feel pretty good that you do not have Lyme disease. So that's kind of the order to look for things.
Is that rash around the tick bite area or just could pop up anywhere? Yep.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, most cases it's going to be, you could think about the bullseye of that rash being where the tick bit you. Yeah. But you can also develop multiple rashes, multiple bullseye rashes around your body, but feel pretty good that the first one at least almost guarantees going to be where that tick bit you.
Tick bites are gross. I mean,
The whole life cycle of the tick is gross.
When you get bit by a bee or an ant or
mosquito, get stung, that's cool.
It goes away, but a tick bite, I mean, it just festers for months sometimes.
Yeah, and then think about what they've been eating on before they get on you. Gross.
Dr. Rich, being that you're in Massachusetts, have you been bitten by any of these ticks that are carrying Lyme disease and had to take any precautions yourself?
Yeah, I've been bitten by many ticks over the years, and I've done what Dr. Brown described, the prophylaxis. So I call up my doc and I'll get a two-day course of antibiotics and take it's called doxycycline.
Oh yeah, good stuff.
That's the idea. The idea is to hit it before it really takes hold. I've never, knock wood, never had infection. I've never had Lyme disease, never tested positive. But I haven't bitten by a lot of ticks.
Yeah, well, we sure are glad that there's people like you out there in the world studying this kind of stuff. Let's pretend there's somebody listening to this and they might be going to, to give a tick check to their girlfriend and they find she's got a tick.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Lyon, is that your bookie calling?
Now we pat out on Tuesdays.
Okay. Well, so let's go. So we find she's got a tick. What's the best way to remove it? As a child, a lot of people told me you could put Vaseline over them and they would back out. Yeah. Or you could light a match and then
Burn your girlfriend.
Touch that hot match and the tick would back out. What's the latest way the best way to get a tick out?
The best way to get the tick off is with a fine pair of tweezers. So if you can get down close to the skin and you can pluck it off. But we always tell people just get them off as quickly as you can. So if you're out in the woods and you don't have your tweezers with you and you can get a fingernail and get that thing off there, pull it off. What you probably hear, and it's a myth, is that if you pull the tick off and the head breaks off, or if you squeeze out the contents or any of those number of things, none of those things are biologically true because, well, for one thing, ticks don't have heads. They are gross, but they don't have a head. They have just sort of mouth parts that they stick into you. And if those mouth parts get separated from the body, by definition, you killed that tick. The tick's dead. And dead ticks don't transmit Lyme disease. As soon as the tick is dead, it stops transmitting. For the same reason that Lyon brought up, that they have to be on you for a certain length of time, there's a very a biological process that they have to go through. And when they're dead, that process doesn't carry through. And the idea of squeezing them, people worry about, well, if I pluck it off, I might squeeze things out. They actually have a block in their pharynx, so in their throat, that doesn't allow them to regurgitate. So they don't, things don't come back out. The only way things come out of the tick into you is through the salivary glands. And once the tick is dead, the salivary glands aren't going to squeeze, and you can't squeeze them. They're not sacs that can be squeezed that way. So get them off as quickly as you can. Fine pair of forceps. I carry one around with me when I'm out in the woods. If I'm hunting or out, going to be out in tick country, or when I'm out collecting ticks, I carry a little tweezer in my back pocket and pull them out that way. And if I don't have it, I just use my fingernail and poke them up.
Well, this guy knows a lot. I bet you're a lot of fun at a cocktail party. Everybody's asking you all kind of interesting questions.
Yeah, but they itch when they ask them. So,
yeah. You
know. Well, I'm glad to hear. Did you hear him say hunting?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I think we have a kindred spirit.
That's
there.
Exactly right.
Amateur, but yeah.
Well, I mean, we got Mac here. He's and then we got Dudley on the other side. So we're Lanny and I are kind of surrounded by some amateurish.
Thank you, Richie.
Appreciate you throwing me in there, Bobby.
Oh me. Well,
are there any other tick-borne illnesses we need to discuss? I know we were mainly going to focus on limes and deer, but are there any others we need to be afraid about?
There's two others that are relatively common. Unfortunately, they don't have nice names. So one is called anaplasmosis. It's named after the bacterium that causes it. It's unlike Lyme disease. It's actually a blood-borne infection. So it infects the cells that are part of your immune system. And that makes it particularly insidious. And then there's a second disease that's transmitted by the same black-legged ticks called babesiosis, which is a malaria-like illness. Again, gets inside your blood cells and can lead to these bloodborne infections. The real downside of babesia, none of these are a cakewalk, right? But the downside of babesia, the malaria-like illness, is that it's not susceptible to doxycycline. So you can't treat it with antibiotics because it's not a bacterium. And you need a treatment that's more akin to the types of treatment that people would get for malaria.
Goodness gracious.
Luckily, like you said, anaplasmosis, and there's another one, ehrlichiosis. You treat both of those with doxy, just like you would Lyme disease, as well as the southern-borne tick illness, you know, like he was talking about, the Lone Star tick. All those tick diseases, even Rocky Mountain spotted fever you get from ticks, all those you treat with doxy. So like he was saying, bring in the tick a lot. But if you come into office, Mississippi, you say you're bit with a tick, and you have these symptoms, you can throw doxy at it, feeling pretty good that it's going to cover whatever tick it was. And like he said, the interesting thing about babesiosis is that you do treat it completely differently, very similar to malaria.
Boy, I didn't realize ticks carried all that. It makes me just dislike them even more.
Well, I mean, I treated my clothing with permethrin right before turkey season, and I only pulled one tick off of myself the whole season, and it hadn't even bit me yet. So
it's pretty good.
Yeah. So I hadn't had one tick this year, knock on wood, but I've been wearing our friends that at Game High have that Limitic, right. And I've been wearing a Limitic pants with that. It's got something already baked into it, and it works. I don't get any ticks on me.
Well, on the other hand, I've had several, but I didn't do anything. So that's probably why it was. But
Mac,
luckily,
what about you?
I didn't have a single tick on me until this past weekend, and I pulled three off crawling, one that's sunk its fangs in me.
Fangs.
Got him.
Yeah, we hate him.
Stuck him.
So I'm looking at the screen. Dr. Lyon Brown, thank you for joining us. We know you've got a busy day, and you took some time out to jump
on
here
with us.
Yeah,
thanks for being here.
You had your bookie calling.
I enjoyed it. Lanny, Dudley, good to see y'all.
Yes, sir. Always good to see you.
Join y'all in the booth.
Come on.
Usually about this time, we kind of turn it over to Dudley, and he asks our guests a few questions that we try to learn a little bit about you. And I think he's got some questions prepared. And then after that, we've got another trivia question for you that we'd like to ask.
Okay, so Dr. Rich, we call it rapid fire. So I'd like you to answer them pretty quickly, almost like a game show or something. And I try to make these questions based on where you're from and some of your hobbies. I only knew that you were a doctor that specialized in insect type pathogens. So not a whole lot to go off of, but are you ready?
So let me say this before we get started. So the rapid fire is brought to you by Springfield Armory.
That's right.
And they're our friends here. They make some fantastic pistols and also some pretty high-end AR framed black rifles.
Oh, nice.
I don't know if you knew this, but our young protege out in the warehouse, Riley, has been testing one of the Springfield rifles, and he really likes it.
Oh, good. Working on the feral nice. Pig population.
Yeah. Yeah, he's got a good scar on his forehead from...
It thumped him.
So, I digress. So, Dudley, turning it back over to you.
Okay, so are you ready?
I'm a little nervous, but yeah, I'm ready.
All right. Marcus Camby or Julius Erving?
Marcus Camby.
Johnny's Tavern or Bistro 63?
Oh my goodness, Johnny's Tavern, for sure.
Lobster roll or clam chowder?
Clam chowder.
Hot tea or iced tea?
Hot tea.
Chicken, white meat or dark?
Dark.
Would you rather go to a cabin on a lake or Martha's Vineyard?
Martha's Vineyard.
Okay. Hunting and fishing or camping and exploring?
Hunting and fishing.
There we go.
All right. Oatmeal or grits?
Oatmeal.
Basketball or hockey?
Hockey. 100%.
And last but not least, shampoo or shampoo plus conditioner?
Shining compound.
Great job.
We've got another trivia question that we want to ask. And look, here, the way this thing works, if you get this one of our listeners have left a review of the podcast, and if we randomly select them, if you get the question right, the listener wins a fabulous prize. If you get the question wrong, you get to send them a bunch of ticks through the mail. We're playing for All Red 601. Not sure what that means, but he left us a review. And so he's got a chance at winning these Leopold sunglasses. So the question is, and I'm looking around the room. I'm going to pass a little something around the room here. But the question is, where were Fig Newtons invented?
So I would go to Massachusetts.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
Whoa, he got it. Yeah.
They were invented in Newton, Massachusetts.
Well, I'll be.
I thought we'd teach people something there. Yes. I thought that
and
would be.
And you got
be,
some samples here.
I brought some samples, some Fig Newton samples. I figured that was like a source of pride for people from Massachusetts. Well.
Yeah.
Apparently
yeah,
not.
Sounds familiar.
Well, I tell you that they're loaded with calories. My wife informed me this morning that because I ate about a dozen of them last night, and she said, you know, they're 50 calories a piece.
Yeah, it's nothing but sugar and carbs, basically. Natural sugars, though.
Well, Dr. Rich, we've enjoyed having you for sure. And listening to all this, it's kind of scary.
It is kind of scary. I still think about how cool the whitetail is. I mean, that's what's so cool to me about it. I mean, yeah, ticks. Obviously, we're going to have to fight them. Hey, but you know what you can do? Burn in the summer. Isn't that right, Dudley? Burn in the fall.
Well, yeah. You know, Dr. Marcus Lashley et al. Has been working on these studies, and you know, a lot of controlled fire can reduce the tick populations.
Yeah. So use permethrin and don't not go outside. That's obviously not what to do.
Yeah. What was Dr. Rich is nodding his head, shaking his head. So have you heard about there's like these fires, these prescribed fires is helping with control the tick population in areas?
Not so much here. No, but I always think, you know, the more people know, the more people listen to the shows like yours and hear the information, you always make better decisions when you have good information. So yeah. We don't make good decisions when we're fearful. We don't make our best decisions when we're scared. When you're running away from the bear, you're not making as good a decision as when you know what you're up against.
That's a good
way to look at it.
Speaking of running from the bear, so tell us a little bit about yourself and your hunting. What's going on up there with you?
Oh, well, I grew up in upstate New York on Lake Ontario and grew up with my dad duck hunting. Dad used to take me out before I went to school and before he went to work, we'd go out and duck hunt all through the season. Then later he got me into deer hunting when I was an older individual. I fell away from it for a long time, but it was always a way of connecting with my dad, who passed away in 2022. But now I'm carrying it on and teaching my son how to deer hunt. And,
nice.
Yeah. That is
that's
good.
Awesome.
So is that where you guys are hunting? Is that the Adirondacks?
It's west of the Adirondacks. It's kind of sandwiched between the Adirondacks and the Thousand Islands. People think it's Canada, but it's far, far north.
Mm-hmm. I bet y'all have some good deer up there.
Yeah, but some big old whitetails.
Beautiful
up there.
Yeah.
A lot of deer up there. One of the biggest military bases up there, Fort Drum, is just loaded with deer.
But no turkeys. None up there.
There's turkeys.
Yeah.
I know they're safe from Dr. Brown.
Yeah. A good one. So look, I'm going to sign you up to get our Gamekeeper magazine. I think you'll enjoy that. And you can pass that along to your son. And then I'm also going to get your shirt size. And we're going to send you a companion shirt. It's a
nice.
The companions is something new. Some of the Mossy Oak websites, you'll see it's an old brand we revised. And there's some wonderful casual clothing there. So we really appreciate having you. You sound like you are really on top of things. We love having smart people on and learning from them.
Yeah, it's been my pleasure to be on. Thanks for putting up with my accent.
No, that was great.
Not very much of an accent.
No.
And we did learn a lot. You do a really good job at putting it in terms that us common people can understand. So I appreciate that.
Great.
All right. Well, thank you, sir. We really appreciate it. Lanny, I always ask, what did you learn?
I kind of hit on a little bit. I just continue to be amazed. I've always been infatuated with whitetails and just, you know, how they make it. So anyways, it's really cool to think about how they could have a profound effect on something that's, you know, is really impacting America, especially outdoor enthusiasts, in a positive way. Mm. Was that pontificating enough?
Yeah, that is. And it gives us hope that, I mean, smart people like Dr. Yeah. Rich that are out there working on this and yeah. they find little breakthroughs, and maybe this just opens up another door and inspires.
It's really intriguing. It really is.
And if there's any young folks out there that are wondering about what they want to do in school, you know, whether it's wildlife, fisheries, forestry, whatever, entomology is always out there in the medical field, and maybe you could tie the two together and add to the list of people that are researching this. There's a lot of unknowns out there.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah, it is. Well, so Mac, you got anything else to add?
Get ticks off of you when you get them.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like I got one.
I'm going to the mirror when we get done, just to be sure.
Yeah. All right. Well, I tell you what, I've enjoyed it. I feel like we learned something. And,
absolutely.
We certainly had some great guests. And we might end up needing to get Dr. Rich back on. It sounds like this is going to be something ongoing.
I want to hear some updates for sure.
Yeah, no doubt about it.
Yeah. Yep. All right. Well, why don't you say goodbye, Dudley?
Goodbye, Dudley.
Get us out of here, Richie.
Thanks for tuning in to this week's episode of the Gamekeeper Podcast. And be sure to tune in again. Subscribe to Gamekeeper Farming for Wildlife magazine. And don't miss the Mossy Oak Properties Fistful of Dirt podcast with my good buddy, Ronnie Cuz Strickland.